Hello everyone, welcome to another episode of Prelims Form Up. In this initiative, which has been brought to you by ActiPlus Academy for Civil Services, we will be discussing some important previous year questions. And you know that previous year questions are very, very important for UPSC prelims. So in each of the episodes, we'll be taking up 5 questions. And similarly, in this episode, we also have 5 questions for you, which we'll be discussing in details. My name is Shayak Datta, and I'm the Faculty for Geography and Environment at ActiPlus Academy for Civil Services. So let us start this session. The first question that we'll deal with was asked in the year 2013 in UPSC prelims. The first question is asking, with reference to the food chain in ecosystems, which of the following kinds of organism is or are known as decomposer organism or organisms? This was asked in the year 2013, and the question is asking, okay, with reference to the food chain in ecosystem. So you know that food chain, food web, these topics are very important in our UPSC environment syllabus. So with reference to the food chains in ecosystem, which of the following kinds of organism is or are known as decomposer organism or organisms? So the first option that you have is virus, the first one. Second is fungi, and the third is bacteria. So out of this, you have to choose which are decomposer organism or organisms. So out of these, we get to see that apart from virus, the other two, that is fungi and bacteria, both of these are examples of decomposer organisms. On the other hand, virus is not exactly a decomposer organism as such. So out of the three, we get to see the answer should be 2 and 3. So let us see the options. In option A, we have 1 only. Option B says 2 and 3 only. Option C says 1 and 3 only. And option D, 1, 2, and 3. So as you can understand, the right answer should be B, 2 and 3 only. So let us see the explanation for this. The explanation and answer, as you can see, is B, 2 and 3 only. You see, fungi and bacteria, they are examples of decomposers. What do they do? Decomposers, what they're supposed to do? They break down organic matter into simple inorganic substances. Virus, on the other hand, it represents dormant life. They are metabolically inactive, as they are inactive as long as they are outside a host body. So basically, virus, it needs a host to become active. So they are metabolically inactive as long as they are outside a host body, and they are not decomposers. They invade the host cells and use their nucleus or the DNA machinery to carry out their life processes. They are also, this decomposer organisms, they are also called as saprotrophs. Okay? Saprotrophs is the term which is used for decomposer organisms, saprotrophs. They are mostly bacteria and fungi that feed on dead and decomposed matter. Similarly, you will also have protists, which are unicellular organisms such as Paramecium and Euglena, but they are not decomposers either. So out of the given options, we get to see that the bacteria and fungi, these are examples of decomposers, but not virus. Virus, they need a host to be active. So this is the first question. Moving on to the second question that we have, and this is also with regards to food chain. This was asked in the year 2014, and it was quite a complex question, a difficult one. If you do not have any prior knowledge, it will be difficult for you to answer this particular question if you are going to attempt it in the real exam scenario, in the actual exam scenario. So let us see what the question was saying. Okay, which one of the following is the correct sequence of a food chain? So given there are four options which have been given, and in each of the options we have 3 species which have been mentioned. Now you have to select the correct sequence of food chain. Now, what is a food chain? Food chain is basically the sequential manner in which one organism will feed upon the other at various trophic levels. Okay, so if you have gone through the concept of food chain, then you will know, okay, there are different trophic levels. For example, we have the primary producer, we have the primary consumer, we have the secondary consumer, we have the tertiary consumer or the apex predators. So there are a number of trophic levels. So let us see. The first option A, it says diatoms, crustaceans, herrings. Number two, crustaceans, diatoms, herrings. Crustaceans, they will be fed upon diatoms, and then they'll be fed upon by herrings. Number C, diatoms, herrings, and then crustaceans. Diatoms, then comes herrings, and then crustaceans, and then comes crustaceans, herrings, and diatoms. So let us try to understand one by one. Number one, matlab, you see, if you are actually appearing in the examination, so let's say you are appearing in 2014 UPSC prelims, and if you had encountered this question, then for you to be able to come to the right conclusion sitting in the examination hall would have been very, very difficult. Why? Because diatoms, still you might be aware, but then crustaceans, basically you must be aware about crustaceans, that crustaceans are those organisms which will be having a shell-like structure, which is made up of calcium most of the times, and then herrings, and you might be confused to what is herrings. So the thing is, if you don't know such kind of questions, it's best to skip, because it's very difficult to actually come to a or to give an educated guess in this one, in this particular case, if you do not have any prior knowledge. So diatoms, it's, you can still guess from the name itself, you can understand that they are supposed to be very, very microscopic in nature. They are like zooplanktons. Then we have crustaceans. Crustaceans are like those creatures which have shell like structure. Similarly, like things like you can have crabs, you can have lobsters. On the other hand, you can also have very, very small creatures which are having shells like shrimps. Okay, herrings, on the other hand, they are fish. So like this, on that basis, you have to arrange them. So let us first see a diagram. As you can see in this particular diagram, which I have given, diatoms, they are examples of producers. And these diatoms, they'll be fed upon by zooplanktons, which are the primary consumers. And then we will get to see fish will be feeding upon these zooplanktons, and then man will feed upon the fish. So this is like how the entire food chain has been structured. So in this particular one, first let us see the explanation and then we'll come to the answer. Then you'll be able to understand it better. So you see here, the food chain ideally should start with the producer, and any food chain, it ideally should end with the top consumer usually. Now, in case of the aquatic ecosystem, we get to see that phytoplanktons, they are the primary producer in the ocean, and these phytoplanktons, they will also include diatoms. Okay. So basically phytoplanktons, they include diatoms, and phytoplanktons, they are the primary producer. In case of an aquatic ecosystem, when you talk about the terrestrial ecosystem, there you will get to see the primary producer, that can be the green plants. But when it comes to the oceans, the seas, there the primary producer, it is usually the phytoplanktons. The phytoplanktons then will be fed upon by the zooplanktons. And we get to see that crustaceans, they are a very large group of arthropods. They include species like crabs and lobsters, crayfish, but at the same time, they will also include very, very tiny creatures like shrimps, like krill, barnacles, and these shrimp, krill, barnacles, they will feed upon the diatoms. What will they feed upon? They are very small. They will feed upon even smaller organisms like the diatoms. And then, of course, the biggest out of the given three, the herrings, they are fish, and they will be eating the small crustaceans like shrimps and krill and all these. Okay, so the correct answer should be A, diatoms, which is the smallest. They will be fed upon by the shrimps, the krill, etc., which are crustaceans, and these shrimp, krill, etc., will be fed upon by the fish, which are the herrings. So our answer should be 2A. Okay, now moving to the third question that we have. And this third question, it is on a very important problem that we get to see in many of the Indian cities, especially in Delhi every winter, and that is called as the smog. So if you have been going through the newspapers, then you will be aware that every winter in Delhi, smog is a very, very big problem. It's a very, very big environmental problem. And in this year, it is going to get aggravated because of the already, because what happens is when smog happens, there will be a lot of respiratory troubles. Already, the coronavirus is creating havoc in Delhi, and this is going to add to this entire issue. So what is this photochemical smog? The question was asked in the year 2013. So photochemical smog, it is a resultant. The photochemical smog, it is a resultant of the reaction between certain substances. So what kind of substances? For example, we will have, so you have been given four options. So you have nitrogen dioxide, you have ozone, and you have peroxyacetyl nitrate in the presence of sunlight. Number two, you have carbon monoxide, you have oxygen, and you have peroxyacetyl nitrate in the presence of sunlight. Carbon monoxide, carbon dioxide, and nitrogen dioxide at low temperature. And finally, you have high concentration of nitrogen dioxide, ozone, and carbon monoxide in the evening. Now you see over here, smog. Smog is basically a phenomena which is seen when you have the combination of smoke and fog. But smog, again, they can be of two types. One type is what we call as the industrial smog, and the other is what is called as the photochemical smog. Industrial smog mainly is when you have smoke from the industries and factories mixing with the fog which has formed over an area, then it gives rise to industrial smog. But on the other hand, when we talk about photochemical smog, then mostly we get to see the exhaust fumes from automobiles that is involved. Plus, there are certain very, very important substances that you should be aware of. Another thing, let me tell you before I go to the answer, when it comes to industrial smog, it is also referred to as London type of smog. When we talk about industrial smog, it is also referred to as London type of smog. On the other hand, when we talk about photochemical smog, it is also called as Los Angeles type of smog. So industrial smog is also called as London type of smog. And when we talk about photochemical smog, it is also called as Los Angeles type of smog. Another thing that you should also be aware of is when we say photochemical, you see the term, it starts with photo. Photo or phyto basically refers to light. Photo or phyto, it basically refers to light. Okay. So out of the given options, we get to see the answer should be A. The answer should be A. And where will you get it? You will get it in NCERT itself. So chemistry class 11, you will have environmental chemistry over there. If you check, you will get to see the answer. They have given you the entire equation, and from there you can get the answer. But let's come to the most important part, that is how this photochemical smog is formed. You see, nitrogen dioxide, okay, nitrogen dioxide that will combine with water and come down in the form of nitric acid. So one of the important thing for photochemical smog is what? Nitric acid, number one. Number two, we have peroxyacetyl nitrate. Peroxyacetyl nitrate. Now, how is this peroxyacetyl nitrate formed? That is not that important, but just in case if you want to know, you have a reaction between nitrogen dioxide taking place with oxygen, which again, after reacting with hydrocarbons, etc., it gives rise to two things. One is the peroxyacetyl nitrate, and the other is aldehyde. Especially, we get to see formaldehyde will be formed. And we get to see the third type or the third important thing that is present is ozone. So, agar aapse poocha jaye, please remember nitric acid, peroxyacetyl nitrate, aldehyde, especially formaldehyde, ozone, hydrocarbons, and you will definitely need sunlight. That is why it is called as photochemical smog. The entire reaction between all of these components will take place only in the presence of sunlight. Without sunlight, this entire reaction cannot take place. Okay, so photochemical smog, it requires the presence of sunlight. So here I have also given you the differences between industrial smog and photochemical smog. Let us quickly go through the differences between them. Industrial smog, also called as London type of smog. Okay, London smog, yeah, London type of smog, because at one point of time in London also such kind of smog used to be very, very frequent and prevalent. That is when London or UK or Britain was undergoing industrial revolution. So smog used to be a regular occurrence over there. Similarly, when we talk about photochemical smog, it is also called as Los Angeles type of smog. When it comes to industrial smog, it is grayish in color. When it comes to photochemical smog, it is brownish in color. Okay, industrial smog is grayish. Photochemical smog, it is brownish in color. Industrial smog, this sulfurous smog is mostly from the burning of coal or oil at large power plants. Okay, so basically this industrial smog, it is formed from the emissions from thermal power plants where you have the burning of coal oil taking place. On the other hand, when it comes to photochemical smog, we get to see that solar radiation, as we have just now discussed, solar radiation, it will play a very big role. in this type of smog. And in case of industrial smog, we get to see that sulfur oxides and particulates, they combine under certain conditions. They combine under certain conditions and they result in the formation of industrial smog. On the other hand, when it comes to when it comes to the Los Angeles type of smog, or what we call as photochemical smog, we get to see reactions. It involves nitrogen oxides and organic compounds like hydrocarbons. It is directly related to the automobile use. So it is mainly because of the emissions or the exhaust fumes from automobiles. Okay. So remember these differences between industrial smog and photochemical smog. Now, moving on to the next question that we have. The next question again was asked in 2013. And this is with regards to some protected area and the important physical feature which is located nearby. And such kind of questions we get to see have been asked by UPSC time and again, where they have mentioned the name of some protected area. And along with that, they have asked you to tally, or they have asked you to match any important physical feature like a mountain range, like a river, etc., etc. So let us see. First is Knockreek Biosphere Reserve. Knockreek Biosphere Reserve, which is a very important one. Knockreek Biosphere Reserve, it is in Garo Hills. Is that correct? We will see. Number two, Loktak Lake. Loktak Lake, it is present in the Barail Range. Number three, Namdhapa National Park. It is in Dafla Hills. So these are the three which have been given, and you have to find out what is correct. So before again, we see the answer. Okay, the answer will be A, only one, but why is it A? Let us try to understand. First of all, Knockreek Biosphere Reserve, is it present in Garo Hills? Let us see. Here I have included a particular diagram where you can see the important hills that we have to focus on. What are those hills? As per this question, there are three hills which have been mentioned. One hill that you can see that is called as the Garo Hills. So over here we have the Garo Hills. Next, let us see, which is the next hill that we have, or is the Barail Range. So where do we have the Barail Range? We have the Barail Range over here. This is the Barail Range. Okay. And the third hill that has been mentioned is the Dafla Hills. So let us look at the Dafla Hills. Where is the Dafla Hills? Here is the Dafla Hills. Okay, so now focus on these three hills. And we get to see in the first case, Knockreek Biosphere Reserve, it has been matched with the Garo Hills. So we have to find that out. Second, we get to see Loktak Lake. Now, Loktak Lake is a very, very important lake. Basically, it is the largest freshwater lake in Northeast India. This is the largest freshwater lake in Northeast India. Not only is it famous for being the largest freshwater lake in Northeast India, but the most important reason why it is so famous is because it houses the only floating national park in the world. So the only floating national park in the world is present on this Loktak Lake, which is called as the Kibul Lamjau National Park. And this was also asked by UPSC. Kibul Lamjau National Park, K-E-I-B-U-L, Kibul Lamjau National Park. Okay. And it is and why is it a national park? We get to see that there is a presence of a very important species which is endemic to that area. And that is the name, and the name is Manipuri deer. Manipuri deer, also called as dancing deer. Okay, it is called as Manipuri deer, or also called as dancing deer. So this particular deer species, it is found only in this particular national park, that is Kibul Lamjau National Park. And in this Kibul Lamjau National Park also, we get to see that there are some roundish islands made up of rotting vegetation, which are called as fumris. Okay, so if you are asked what are fumris, P-H-U-M-D-I-S, fumris. So these fumris are nothing but roundish islands which are made up of rotting vegetation, which are present on this Loktak Lake. Also, we will get to see Loktak Lake is important because under the Ramsar Convention, Ramsar Convention, basically it is a list, or under Ramsar Convention, there's a list of wetlands of international importance. So this Loktak Lake is also a Ramsar site, which makes it a wetland of international importance. But we get to see that there are two such Ramsar sites in India, which are included under another list, which is called as the Montreux Record. The Montreux Record basically is a list of those Ramsar sites which are facing or will be facing a threat from either natural or man-made activities, that is from natural or anthropogenic activities, if if a Ramsar site faces threat, tab jaki that Ramsar site is put under another list, which is called as the Montreux record. From India, there are two such Ramsar sites which are included under the Montreux record. Number one is the Loktak Lake, and number two, we have another lake which is present in Rajasthan. Okay, we have another which is also called as the Bharatpur, in Bharatpur National Park, which is famous for birds. So that particular area, it is also called as Keoladeo-Ghana. So Bharatpur National Park or Keoladeo-Ghana National Park, so which is very famous for migratory birds, especially for Siberian cranes, and that is present in Rajasthan. So these two places, one is Keoladeo-Ghana National Park of Rajasthan, the other is Loktak Lake, which is in Manipur. These two places are included under the Montreux record, which is a list under the Ramsar site or Ramsar convention, and it basically is a list of those Ramsar sites which are threatened by natural or by man-made activities. Now let us go back to the question. Once again, I have discussed with you the importance of the Loktak Lake. So Loktak Lake has been mapped with the Barail range at Namthapa National Park. It has been mapped with the Dafla Hills. Now let us see. First of all, over here, Loktak Lake, I have already mentioned, it is in Manipur, and importance being the presence of the Kibul Lamjau National Park, which is the only floating national park in the entire world. Okay, now see the location of Loktak Lake. See here we have the Loktak Lake. Okay, and Loktak Lake was mapped with what? Loktak Lake was mapped with the Barail Range. Look at the location of Barail Range over here. So Barail Range is here, and where did we see Loktak Lake? Loktak Lake was near this Manipur. Here was Loktak Lake, and Barail Range is far away. So you can understand that there is a difference in the location, and hence this definitely cannot be correct. This mapping can definitely, cannot be correct. You can understand that. Next one is Namthapa National Park in Dafla Hills. Let us try to understand where is Namthapa. Here we have Nokrek. Okay, here we have Nokrek, and you see Nokrek, it is surrounded by West Garo Hills, East Garo Hills, and South Garo Hills. Understood? Nokrek, that is Nokrek Biosphere Reserve. It is surrounded by the West Garo Hills, East Garo Hills, South Garo Hills, and we get to see that Nokrek Biosphere Reserve, it was mapped to Garo Hills. Is that correct? Yes, definitely that is correct. Because from the map itself, you can understand that Nokrek, it is surrounded by the Garo Hills. West Garo Hills, East Garo Hills, and South Garo Hills, they surround Nokrek Biosphere Reserve. The last one is Namthapa National Park. So Namthapa is located over here in Arunachal Pradesh. Namthapa is situated over here in Arunachal Pradesh. Where is Dafla? Dafla Hills, that is what it was mapped to, right? Look at the location of Dafla Hills. Dafla Hills is over here. And where was Namthapa? It is present on the Dafla Hills, that is here. So there's a huge difference between the locations. So you can understand this third one, this third mapping is also incorrect. So only A1 only is the right answer. I hope you have been able to understand. And it is very difficult for you to remember, actually, until and unless you know the exact location of the hill ranges. So yes, Dafla is over here, Barail is over here, Garo is over here, and the rest of the hills you can see. So please go through the different locations of the important hill ranges. Especially we get to see UPSC has this has this habit of asking the protected areas which are present in the northeast mainly. So do have a look at the protected areas of the northeast. Now moving on, the next question, the last question for the day. Here again we get to see another very typical question which UPSC likes to ask, and that is they will be again asking the, or they will be putting the name of a protected area, and they will be asking you to match that protected area with an important physical feature which is present near to that protected area. For example, in this particular question which was asked in the year 2013, we get to see that UPSC has put the name of important national parks on one side, and on the other side they have asked you whether these rivers flow through these national parks. So let us see the rivers and the national parks. Number one is Corbett National Park, and it has been mapped to Ganga. Kaziranga has been mapped to Manas, and then we get to see Silent Valley National Park. It has been mapped to the river Kaveri. Very, very difficult once again. Until and unless you are 100% sure, please do not try to attempt such questions because there are higher chances of you getting it incorrect. Okay, so when it comes to Corbett National Park, is it Ganga? Answer is no, because here we get to see there's a specific river which is called as Ram Ganga, which is a tributary of Ganga, but it is not the actual Ganga. Okay, so we get to see Jim Corbett National Park. It owes its survival to the two rivers that flow through the Jim Corbett Park. One is River Ram Ganga and the other is River Kosi. So remember, when it comes to the Jim Corbett National Park of Uttarakhand, it should be River Ram Ganga and River Kosi. Ram Ganga River, along with its tributaries, that is Palayan, Mandal and Sonanadi, they serve as a key hydrological resource for the Jim Corbett National Park. Now, again, it is not important for you to go so deep and try to remember all the various tributaries of, you know, Ram Ganga and all such, because these Ram Ganga River, etc., they are also tributaries of Ganga. So you cannot go on trying to remember so many names. So the thing is, remember Ram Ganga and River Kosi, they flow through Jim Corbett National Park. Similarly, when it comes to Kaziranga National Park, we get to see that Brahmaputra, Diflu, Mora Diflu and Mora Dhansiri. These are the names of the rivers which flow through Kaziranga National Park. Again, over here, which is the important river? Brahmaputra. And every year we will get to see the Brahmaputra, it will flood, almost inundating a huge portion of the Kaziranga National Park. And again, when huge portions of Kaziranga National Park, it gets inundated by the water of the Brahmaputra, you'll get to see most of the wildlife, they will migrate to the higher reaches of the Karbi Anglong Hills, which are present to the north. And sometimes, and another thing is, a lot of wildlife, they lose their lives during this point of time because they try to cross the highways, etc., in order to migrate to higher places, because most of the lower parts of Kaziranga would get flooded. But so the disadvantage, or you can say the negative point regarding flooding, is the death of so many wildlife species which take place. But at the same time, please remember, this flooding, it is necessary, because without the flood, we'll get to see many of the species of plants and trees, they will not be able to germinate. So it is the flood which gives life. It takes away life, it also gives life to Kaziranga. It is extremely essential, because every time Brahmaputra floods, we get to see a lot of silt gets deposited in Kaziranga, and that enriches the soil. So yes, Brahmaputra, it flows through Kaziranga. It is responsible for flooding of the Kaziranga every year. But the next important protected area that we have is the Silent Valley National Park. Silent Valley National Park was the site of a huge protest, which is called as the Safe Silent Valley Protest, which took place against the construction, against the establishment of a dam over here, mainly to generate electricity. So Silent Valley National Park, it is the Kunti Puza River which flows through it. And also we get to see if Bharat Puza, if it is mentioned, then also you can mark it as correct. So Kunti Puza, Bharat Puza, these are the kind of rivers you will get to see in the Silent Valley National Park. Silent Valley is called as Silent Valley National Park. Why is it called as Silent Valley? It is called as Silent Valley because of the absence of cicadas. Because of the absence of cicada. Cicada is an insect like the cricket. It makes a noise at night. So if you ever go into the rural areas or near forest, at night you will get to see a constant chirping kind of a sound. That chirping noise is created by cicadas. And it is the absence of this cicada in the Silent Valley National Park, which has given it its name, that is Silent Valley. And also another important thing that you should be aware of is the Silent Valley National Park, it is one of the last refuge of an endemic species, which is only found in the Western Ghats, and that is called as the lion-tailed macaque. It is a type of monkey whose tail resembles that of a lion. Okay, it will also have a mane around its face. So it is called as lion-tailed macaque. It is endemic to the Western Ghats, and a large number of these, this lion-tailed macaque is found in the Silent Valley National Park of Kerala. Okay, so your answer should be D, none of the above. That is the right answer. Okay, so with this, we complete the 5 questions for today. And I hope you have liked this video. And if you have, please like the video, please comment and let us know what you feel about it. Share with your friends and share with other UPSC aspirants. And please subscribe to AptiPlus Academy for Civil Services YouTube channel for more such informative videos. We'll be back again with another episode of Prelims Warm Up. Till then, stay safe and study hard. Thank you so much. I should fuck her in the best.